Recently, I read a remark in Facebook quoting Arindam Chowdhury, stating that Indian people are foolish and that those who believe that there is a Patal Lok, they are doomed. I didn't make any comment excepting to state that today's physics has found that Rigveda has calculated the velocity of light more precise than what our modern physics has said. And also added a line, better ignore these people. That's all. If you want to say, without even going through any of the Indian texts, for that matter, if you want to comment on something, you are expected to read it, study it, analyze it. Because you want to show that you are an intelligentsia and you are a secular human being, and that you will be recognized an intellectual only by ridiculing Indian, anything Indian. Well, you have nothing to comment on those people. So that's why I said it's better those people are left alone instead of wasting your time in trying to repudiate them. That the Rigveda calculates the velocity of light more precise, I have written in my blog site www.ramanam50wordpress.com. Apart from that, I also written lots of references taking from Indian books, textbooks from Sanskrit literature, Sanskrit religious texts, Tamil classicals and Siddhas, cross-verified them with latest researches being carried out throughout the world, of course excepting in India. Of course, now they have just started for 3 or 4 years, where the studies prove whatever has been stated there, these books, textbooks, are scientific. That the darpa, which is being used for performance of ancestral rites and for Brahmins for everyday oblations, has magnetic vibration. And that the homas that are being conducted protects the area where it is being conducted from radiation. Similarly, there are so many studies. I will be talking to you on each of these one by one. Now, to come to this point, one practical application. Now, there are a lot of things about quantum explanations found in Indian philosophy. That will be too technical, which of course, since it is going to be heavy, I will deal later separately. For the time being, a practical application of the Vedic mantras stated in the Vedas are being used. There is an organization in Bangalore which produces electricity by using the mantras from the Vedas. The input is 126 watts, 126, and the output is 303. There is a gain. What is this based on? Vedas, as you probably may know, are the scriptures of the Hindus. It normally contains, it generally contains 4 parts. Samhitas, which contain hymns addressed to various gods and goddesses, seeking blessings, seeking protection. And the next part is called Brahmanas, which explain and lays down the rules for rightful living for every human being. Aranyakas are another portion, which according to the station one is placed in his life, that is, one is a belief, celibate, brahmacharya. Second is Grihastha, and the third is Vanaprastha, where he is retired, semi-detached, then Sannyasi. The third portion, Vanaprastha, he is expected to leave everything in a detached way after handing over family responsible to the eldest son, retire himself in the Aranya, that is in the forest, and meditate on the reality. If his wife agrees with him, he can take her. These Aranyakas deal with the rites to be conducted in Aranyaka. The next comes Upanishad. Upanishad is the ultimate of Vedic teaching. It is called Vedanta, the end of the Vedas. That talks about reality, descriptive, and also tells you how to go about it. So in the Samhitas, there are hymns. These hymns are normally chanted for one's practical problems in life. See, people may make fun of praying. I remember, I think it is Tennyson. I'm not too sure, but I remember the quote. Prayer may not change God, but at least it changes the man who prays. I completely believe it. And I have my own personal experiences. I could even call them as paranormal. There is something called as paranormal in Indian philosophy. Everything is natural. There is no word in Sanskrit which says something is a miracle. There is nothing called a miracle. It is the best word that could be used to describe miracle is called avyakta, that is indescribable. You can't describe it. Everything in nature is natural. There is nothing miracle. There is nothing beyond nature. Okay. Now I am just straying from the topic. Now in these hymns, there are certain hymns when you chant them, the way they have to be chanted, they deliver you some specific results. For example, for warding of diseases, for ridding of evil eye, for black magic, so many prayers are there, and for general welfare for every human being. Of this, there are suktas. Suktas are a collection of hymns addressed to you different deities. There are, so even though there are many suktas in Vedas, five are called Panchamrita. Panchamrita means the five nectars. Of these five nectars, what are they? They are called Purusha Sukta, Narayana Sukta, Vishnu Sukta, Sri Sukta, and Durga Sukta. These five are chanted in every temple, even today, along with Sri Rudra and Shamaka. These five suktas, if chanted regularly at home, the practical problems one faces in life will disappear, and you will get the mental strength to deal with them. Now, this Purusha Sukta is regarded as the highest of the suktas. Purusha Sukta in general describes the evolution of the universe. Indian philosophy differs from Darwinian thought in that the world has evolved with some principles. The theory of evolution in Indian philosophy is different. So that evolution is described. Cosmic evolution is described in the Purusha Sukta. The Purusha Sukta addresses to Purusha, that is the active principle, male principle. In general, there are two principles accepted in Indian philosophy. Of course, there are two principles, three principles, non-two principles, qualified in non-principle, they come later. But all these attributes we give to any mantra or reality are only relative. They are in the process of evolution. The way your mental disposition is, you interpret them. So all these suktas lend themselves to various meaning. In essence, all these suktas, number one, they give you a specific result when you pray for. That is the general concept in all these samhitas, in all the Vedas. But that's a deeper meaning. In any Vedic mantra, and also in some Tantra Shastra. Tantra Shastra is different, slightly different from Veda Mantras. In Veda Mantras, every mantra for that matter lends itself to minimum three meanings. Depending on how you approach it, you get the results. The first meaning is the literal translation. From Sanskrit to regional language or any other language you would like to understand, transliteration you call it. Word to word translation. The second one is, it explains a certain principle. For example, in Purusha Sukta, it talks about the evolution in a gradual way. And the third explanation is some secret message, either concerning physical world or metaphysic, is contained therein. And the fourth one is a tantric message which uses, if you can understand those lines properly, the sound, geometrical pattern which you draw, and the image that appears before you or you are asked to keep before you. These three are integrated and Tantra Sadhana can be performed. Now when you use the same thing for Homa, the effect is different, the procedure is different. It may sound a little complex, I'll explain very simple, in simple terms. See, Purusha Sukta is addressed to the universal principle. In essence, what it says is, the world is how it evolves. So it talks about the active male principle. This starts thus. Sahasra Sirusha Purusha Sahasracha Sahasrabad Sabhumim Vishwato Vridba Adya Dirtat Dasangulam Purusha Eveda Gum Sarvam Yat Bhutam Yatsabhavyam. Now, the reality, Purusha is thousands of eyes. Sahasra Sirusha Purusha. That is thousands of heads. Sahasra Akshas Sahasrabha, thousands of eyes. So it keeps on describing this, which basically conveys you it pervades everywhere. The reality is present everywhere. The reality is not something which is outside you. It's not outside the world. It is within you and it is immanent in everything that is living and non-living. This is the first meaning. The second meaning is Sahasra Sirusha Purusha Sahasra Akshas Sahasrabha. Now, out of multitude of reality comes the other principle. Sabhumim Vishwato Vridbha Adya Dritta Dasangulam. Then he says how the earth evolves from that. Then what is the size? Adya Dritta Dasangulam, 1/10 of an inch, that is the thumb height. I'll explain it later, combining it with Tantra Sastra. Purusha Yeveda Gumsarvam Yat Bhutam Yatcha Bhavyam. Then it starts describing the distribution of duties among people based on their disposition. Who does what? Padosya Vishwa Bhudani Tribhadasyamutam Bhudivihi Tribhadurtva Udhait Purushah Padosya Bhavat Punah Tado Vishwam Yakraramadhi. Then it goes. Brahmanosya Mukam Asid Bahurajanya Kritaha Uru Tasasya Yadvaisya Patyagum Shudro Ajayata. This distributes. Now this is how the principles are formed, how the society is by classifying based on the dispersion. This is the second way of interpretation. The third interpretation is that the principles involved in evolution, the active principle in here, in Indian philosophy, Brahma is supposed to be the creator. Now, while reading in this context, Brahma is presumed to sacrifice himself in the fire, Homa fire, to produce the world, seasons of the world. This is how natural things evolve. That comes. And in that process, there are processes which is again reimposed in Sankhya philosophy. Prakriti, Purusha, Mahat. Then you have panchabhuta, panchatanmatra, it goes 24 principles, how they evolve. This is one set. There is yet another set. Way of interpretation is that doing it practically from physics. Now, this is what I am going to talk about. So, by doing this process of producing, understanding these lines properly, applying it practically as a physics principle, the organization run by one Mr. Satish Chandra in Bangalore has been producing electricity, as I said earlier, with input of 126, it gives an output of 303 plus 140 plus is the gain. How is it being done? It is being done by just interpreting the just two lines. Sahasra Sirusha Purusha Sahasraksha Sahasrabhat. That is, the inner interpretation is that of the 10 directions, in Indian philosophy, we don't have 4 directions, we have 10 directions. Of these 10 directions, leaving the 2 directions of earth and ether and earth and sky, for 8 directions, one is expected to place alternators in the form of a circle, and which each of them have plus positive charge and negative charge, and the center you keep a runner. When the runner runs in between these alternators, it produces energy. This is the Purusha Sutra, how it generates electricity. Producing from zero will be a better idea, and the steps are being made to understand the next stanzas so that we could produce more electricity. This is just an example of how basic principles can be adopted. I am providing details of this beneath the video, and also you can read Purusha Sutra Produces Electricity, Ramanan 50. If you Google it, you will get the detailed article. We will see some more interesting facts about Indian philosophy and Hinduism and its presence throughout the world.